Before we begin the second talk, I just want to, I'm Srinivas, a co-organizer of this program. And before we begin the second talk, I want to have an announcement. At 12:30, we'll have a group photograph. So as soon as the lecture is over, kindly gather near the, here, in the, near the library building, okay? Yeah, thank you. So we
okay. So what I'm going to talk about is something called as the Lindstrom Gesell Vienno lemma and some of its applications in algebra and in combinatorics. So this so before I begin, how many of you have heard of this lemma? Sometimes it's called the Gesell-Vienno lemma. Nobody has heard of it? Okay.
It's an interactive program. Please respond.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. So since this is supposed to be not just a refresher course but also enrichment, so I hope we will learn something new. And I will apply this to problems that we will normally deal with. For example, the problem of showing that the determinant is multiplicative. So if you have n cross n matrices and you want to show that the determinant of the product is the product of the determinants, that is one situation in which this lemma is applicable. I'll also show you some other interesting situations where this is applicable. So the area of mathematics that this comes under is sometimes called algebraic combinatorics. So this is a very pleasant mixture of both algebra and combinatorics, that is counting techniques. So this area sort of brings in these two areas together to prove various kinds of results. So I want to motivate this Lindstrom-Gesell-Vienno lemma by taking up the problem of determinants. Yes, I also should mention that whatever I'm going to talk about today is mostly there in this book called Proofs from the Book. By Egner and Ziegler. And if you look at this book, the title of this book, this part is capitalized. And what does this book refer to? So Paul Erdős often used to say that God has a book in which there is a perfect proof for all mathematical theorems, and he refers to it as God's book of proofs. So this book by Egner and Ziegler is supposed to be proofs from God's book. So very, very clever and very beautiful theorems, several of them from various areas of mathematics, are gathered together in this book. And incidentally, this will make wonderful reading for talented undergraduates. So it's something that you can refer your students to. It's a lovely book, lots of results from various parts of mathematics. And what I'm going to talk about is one of the chapters in this book. So this deals with this Lindstrom-Gesell-Vienno lemma. Okay, so as I said, I want to motivate this by starting with determinants. So let us begin with determinants. So begin with a square matrix, n cross n matrix A. So let A be an n cross n matrix. Say we have entries in some field. Or you could even take entries in some commutative ring, it doesn't matter for what I'm going to say. Say the field of rational numbers or real numbers or complex numbers, whatever. So n cross n matrix with entries in K. Now associated to A is its determinant. And which is defined by the following formula, det A is the sum over all permutations in the symmetric group of the sign of this permutation times a product of various elements in this matrix this is the definition of the determinant. Now using this definition of the determinant you can prove various things. So let me just say that Sn is the symmetric group, the set of all 1 to 1 and onto functions from the set 1n to itself. And the sign, by sign it's the homomorphism from Sn into plus minus 1, which takes the even permutations to 1 and the odd permutations to minus 1. So with this definition of the determinant, it's easy to prove some properties of the determinant. So let me just list these out. I'll just list this as exercise 1. These are fairly easy to do. So show the following. With this definition, so prove the following. First, that the determinant is a linear function of each of its columns. By which I mean, if you have two matrices which are exactly the same, except three matrices which are exactly the same except in one column, and in one of them it is the sum of the other two, then the determinant adds. It's a linear function of each of its columns. Similarly for scalar multiplication. Second, determinant vanishes if two columns are equal. And third is a very simple normalization condition. The determinant of the identity matrix is 1. All of these are extremely easy to prove. Easy to prove using this definition. Now, why I have listed all of these out is the following. Let me list a fourth one, which is also not hard to prove. Determinant of the transpose equals determinant of A. Now these three properties, the first three, are somewhat special. They are somewhat special for the following reason, that if you have a function from n cross n matrices over some field K into K satisfying these three conditions, then such a function is unique and it has to be this determinant function. So the usual debt is the only function from n cross n matrices to the field satisfying the first three conditions. Which means necessarily once a function satisfies these three conditions is the usual determinant, and therefore the fourth condition is also satisfied. That is, this is a consequence of these three. It is not obvious in any direct way why it is a consequence. Now this theorem is proved in say R10's book on algebra. Right, so we are all familiar with this statement and this definition of determinants and these elementary properties. Now, one property which is not so obvious from this definition is what I mentioned earlier. It's the property of multiplicativity of determinants. If you have two matrices, n cross n matrices A and B, and you take their product, the product matrix AB, the determinant of the product is the product of the determinants. Now that is not so easy to show using this formula. So we know, this is familiar to all of us, we know this, that the determinant of AB is the product of the determinants. And that's also, the proof is also there in Artin's book. It's not a straightforward proof. You express it as a product of elementary matrices and do various things, and then finally somehow you conclude that the determinant is multiplicative. Now what I want to do is to give a very straightforward proof of this using this Gesell-Viennot lemma in algebraic combinatorics. So what? So in order to do that, I'll need to set up some notations. So I want to motivate. So I want to look at this equation first. So determinant of A, this is the definition of determinant. I want to look at this definition in a somewhat different way. So motivation. For LGV. So Lindstrom Gesell-Viennot lemma. So to motivate this, let me consider a directed graph. Now this directed graph has 2n vertices and one edge between every pair of vertices. So consider the following directed graph. So there are 2n vertices which I will write in 2 lines, right? And I will call them R1 up to Rn, R1, R2, Ri, Rn. And then there are another n vertices which I will write as another line below. I will call those vertices C1 up to Cn, C1, C2. Cj, Cn. So this graph has 2n vertices, and as I said, it has one edge between every pair of vertices. So between each one of these, and sorry, every pair of vertices, no edges connect these among themselves, no edges connect these among themselves, but between the R's and the C, there is one edge. So between, from R1 to C1, there is one. From R1 to C2, there is one. R1 to Cj, there is one. R1 to Cn, there's one. Similarly, from Ri to C1, there's one. Ri to C2, there's one. There's one edge. From every Ri to every Cj, there is one edge, and it's a directed graph. So this edge goes from Ri to Cj. That is why the direction of the arrow is indicated where this edge goes from where to where. Okay, so consider this directed graph. Now, it's not just a directed graph. I also want to give you weights on each of these edges. To each of the edges, I will assign some number called its weight. And this number is just the corresponding entry of the matrix I'm interested in. I've begun with this matrix A, right? So this formula deals with the determinant of a matrix A. So there's, this A has entries Aij. So to the edge from Ri to Cj, I will assign this the weight Aij. So in this directed graph, assign a weight Aij to the edge from Ri to Cj. So there are n squared edges, right? There are n of these, n of these. There's an edge, n edges from here into C1, C2 up to Cn. So there are n squared edges, and there are these n squared Aijs. To each edge, I assign this weight Aij. Now, I want to look at this definition of the determinant, right? I want to look at this definition of the determinant and then see what does this have to do with this graph. Can I express this definition in terms of what is happening in this graph over here? So I want to do that. So to do that, so there are two sides. There is this left hand side and the right hand side. So let me begin with the LHS. So we will interpret, LHS and RHS of the above in terms of this weighted directed graph. Okay, so if I want to interpret this, I have to tell you what is this matrix A? What does this matrix A have to do with this graph? First, that is the interpretation for the LHS. So how this matrix A arises from the graph is as follows. You consider, we have chosen in this graph n vertices which I am calling R1 up to Rn and n vertices which we are calling C1 up to Cn. So the matrix A arises as follows. Consider a matrix whose rows are indexed by R1 to Rn and whose columns are indexed by C1 up to Cn. And what do I put in? If I have Ri here and Cj here, so what is this Ri Cj entry? To get this Ri Cj entry, I go and look at the graph. So I look at the graph, here is Ri, here is Cj. It so happens that there is only one edge from Ri to Cj and that has weight Aij. So I just put in the weight of that edge there. So this weight is Aij, so I just put in Aij. Then of course I complete the whole thing for every I and j, I get back my matrix A. That's how I did it in the first place. So this gives the matrix A. Okay, so that much for, and therefore this side is just the determinant of this matrix. So I'll call this the path matrix for this graph, which will now be called the path matrix for that graph. So I have a way of getting some path matrix. I haven't said what to do in general. For this graph at least, I've got some matrix, the path matrix, and that is just my original matrix. The other side, the RHS, is more interesting to interpret. Now what is this RHS doing? So this RHS can be interpreted. So the interpretation of the RHS is as follows. The interpretation of the RHS is the following. So what we do is we consider something called a path system. A path system is just a collection of paths, right, going from the Ri's to the Cj's. So I want to, so there are n Ri's and n Cj's. So I just take each Ri as I associate to some Cj and consider a collection of paths that I get. So consider a path system. I am defining this term. This is a collection of n paths going from the Ri's to the Cj's. and not just any n paths. These n paths are such that every Ri is joined to a different one, right? There is two different Cj's. For example, I could take R1 is joined to C1, R2 is joined to C1 and something else, but that will leave out some of the Cj's. Or if two of these are joined to the same one, that will leave out some of the R's. So I don't want to consider that. I want to consider path systems which are vertex disjoint. That means they share no common vertices. So consider only vertex disjoint path systems. So they do not share any common vertices. Then what can you do? What you can do is only the following. You will have to associate an R1 to a unique C here, R2 to another unique one. So essentially, how many ways are there of doing it? N factorial ways, right? The first one can go to any n, the second one can go to n minus 1 leaving the one you have chosen, the third one can go to n minus 2 leaving the two you have chosen. So there are n factorial ways, and that exactly accounts for this. Sn also has n factorial elements, so you get your n factorial there, but there's a little more. Okay, so I want to consider a path system which is vertex disjoint, and to this path system I want to associate two things: a permutation and a weight, right? So to such a So to such a path system, associate two things: a permutation in Sn and a weight. Okay, so now I'll tell you what is this permutation that you associate and what is the weight. The permutation that you associate is the obvious one. Since a path system takes different R's to different C's, and all the R's and all the C's are covered, so there is a unique permutation pi such that Ri is joined to C pi I. So the permutation is determined by the following rule: Ri is joined to C pi I. This specifies the permutation pi. And then there is a weight. What is a weight? So now once you join these Ri's to the C pi I's, that means I have chosen R1 goes to C1, R2 goes to C2. Rn goes to Cn. Maybe you have chosen the permutation to be the identity permutation. If I choose the identity permutation, R1 goes to C1, R2 goes to C2, Rn goes to Cn. I take all these edges, right? Each of these edges has a weight. So what will this have? This has A11, this has A22, this has ANN. And the weight of that path system I will define to be the product of the weights of all these edges. So in this case, for this path system, that is for the identity permutation, the weight is A11, A22 up to ANN, the product. If I have some other thing, if I have Ri is joined to C pi I, then the weight of that path system will be the product AI, A1 pi 1, A2 pi 2, A3 pi 3 up to AN pi N. So the weights exactly correspond to these things. So the weight of a path system is the product of the weights of all its edges. And so now I have converted this statement into a statement about the graph. I am saying that take this directed, whatever directed graph, directed weighted graph, and you take its path matrix, then the determinant of the path matrix is the sum over all vertex disjoint path systems of the sign of the permutation associated to that path system times the weight of that path system. So let me write that down. So if G is a directed weighted graph, and you're also given these vertices R1 to Rn and C1 to Cn, R1 to Rn, C1 to Cn are vertices in G. Then the determinant of the path matrix is the sum over all P, which are vertex disjoint path systems of the sign of the permutation associated to P times the weight of P. I have done nothing at all so far. I have just restated this entire thing as this for that particular graph that I have taken. Now, what Lindstrom, Gesell, Viano observed is that this statement is true not just for this graph, it is true for any directed graph. I should add a few more things. It should be finite first, finite directed graphs. And I also have to add that it shouldn't have any cycles, right? It shouldn't have any cycles. It's acyclic. See, this has no cycles, right? You cannot go and come back to the same point. Finite, acyclic, for the following reason. So why are these two conditions necessary? So I'll explain now why these two conditions are necessary. And then the LGV lemma is exactly this one. This is the LGV lemma. Not just for this graph, which is the definition of the determinant, but for any finite directed acyclic weighted graph, this thing is true. So now let me try to explain what is meant by path matrix. I told you what the path matrix was for this graph. What is meant by the path matrix of a general such graph? So what is the path matrix . See, in a general directed graph, if you take, you could have, suppose this was my Ri and this was my some Cj. The path matrix is going to give me one entry, the ij entry is going to be something. But in our case, there was only one edge from Ri to Cj. For every I and j, there was only one edge from Ri to Cj. But in our graph, you may have a path, you may have a path like this. And you may not have just one path, you may have more than one path, right? Your graph maybe you have another path like this. You could have many paths from Ri to Cj. Now, when you have many paths from Ri to Cj, what entry are you going to put in that path matrix? So we have to answer that question. So what you have to do is, the entry in the path matrix . Suppose this has weight A, B, C, D, and this has E, F, G, H, right? Everything has a weight. All these edges have weights. So the entry in the path matrix is the sum over all paths of the product of the edge weights. So for this, there are two paths, and one path has A, B, C, D, another path has E, F, G, H. So the entry in the path matrix here will be, for this one, it will be A, B, C, D for the first path plus E, F, G, H for the second path. Now this will tell you why various restrictions are necessary. So why should the directed graph be finite? The directed graph had better be finite, because if there are an infinite number of paths between A and C, then what sense will this make, right? We can only take finite sums and finite products, so there better not be an infinite number of paths. So we will restrict to finite directed graphs. And why acyclic? Acyclic also for the same reason. If your directed graph looked like this, say, so here is A, B, C. Suppose these are the weights. And suppose this is Ri, and suppose this is also Cj, that's possible. Suppose Ri and Cj are both the same. Now you see that there are an infinite number of paths there. You could go A, B, C, A, B, C any number of times. So again, there will be a problem of what will you mean by adding over all paths. So we do not want to allow cycles, because cycles will produce infinite number of paths. So we rule out cycles. It should be an acyclic graph, and we rule out infinite sums. So it's going to be a finite graph. So if it's a finite acyclic graph, directed and weighted, then the determinant of the path matrix is the sum over all vertex disjoint path systems of the sine of that path system times the weight of that path system. The sine of a path system, when you have a path system between R1 from R1 Rn to C1 Cn, each Ri will be connected to one unique C pi I, because it's vertex disjoint, right? You cannot share any vertices. So that will give you a permutation, and that permutation is what I'm calling as, the sine of that permutation is what I'm calling as sine of that path system. And the weight of the path system is just the product of the weights of all the things along its edges. Okay, so this is the lemma. I haven't proved it. I only said that with this lemma, if you look at the definition of a determinant, it is consistent with this graph. That's all I've said so far. I'm not also going to prove this lemma. I don't think I'll have time. So I'm not going to prove this lemma. But what I would like to do is to show you various nice applications of this lemma in proving theorems. Okay? So are there any questions about the statement of this lemma? Okay, what are the weights? That's a good question. See, the weights can come from some. Yes, certainly. The weights need not be positive. The weights can be any, can come from some field, or can some come from some commutative ring. It doesn't matter. You fix some ring, say, and all the weights come from that particular thing, right? They need not be. What is the usual sense for weights? No, these weights need not be positive or anything. They are just elements of some ring. They need not even be real numbers. They could be x, y, z. Like for there, I just call the weights A, B, C, D. They could be anything. They need not be real numbers or anything like that. Okay. So as I said, I want to illustrate the use of this LGV lemma. So the first use that I want to do is to show that the determinant is multiplicative. Okay, so that's the lemma. So application one. Which is, as I said, the determinant is multiplicative. So what do we have to prove? We have to take two n cross n matrices A and B and show that determinant of AB equals det A det B. So I want to show determinant of AB is the product of det A and det B. Now typically, this is how proofs using the LGV lemma will go. What you will do is, you look at the problem in hand, you will construct an appropriate directed graph, right? Construct an appropriate directed graph for which the path matrix will be this one, right? the determinant term on that side, this side will be the path matrix. So AB will be the path matrix, so determinant of AB will be this side, and somehow you will try to match this with the other side. This is how all the proofs will go. I'm going to do many applications, and all of these applications, the cleverness is in constructing the graph. So we need to construct a graph whose path matrix is AB and whose the other side of the LGV lemma will give det A det B, and therefore by the lemma those two are equal. So what is the graph in this case? So we construct a graph. We consider the following directed graph. Now this graph, previously we had a graph with two n vertices labeled r1 to rn, c1 to cn. So now we will construct a graph with three n vertices. And that looks like this. So here are my first n vertices, which I'll again call r1 to rn, and then there are these bottom vertices, which I'll call c1 to cn, and then there are the middle ones, which I'll just call maybe x1 to xn. So this is a graph which has three n vertices. Now it should be a directed graph, so I have to draw edges and their directions. So the edges are like this. As usual, from each one here there is one edge going downwards. That is the usual, that graph on top, and another copy of that graph below. So from x1 to c1 there is one, from x1 to c2 there is one, x2 to c1, x2 to c2, x1 to cn, xn to cn. Two copies of this graph stuck together along that middle n vertices. That is what is the graph I am going to consider. This graph has three n vertices, and how many edges does it have? Here there are n squared, each of these n is connected to each of these n, and here there is another n squared. So 3n vertices, 2n squared edges. Okay, fine. And I should take a directed graph. Obviously this is acyclic, right? You cannot have any cycles, because you cannot, once you are going down, all the edges move only downwards, you can never go back up, right? So this is clearly an acyclic graph. So it's acyclic, finite, directed graph. Then I should weight it. It should be weighted. Now there are 2n squared weights that you'll have to assign, and obviously if you have two matrices A and B, this has n squared entries, that has n squared entries, so you will just assign appropriately. For example, if you have Ri to Xj, you will assign Aij, and if I have Xj to Ck, I'll assign Bjk. Right? The natural thing, that is exactly two graphs of matrices A and matrices B stuck together along that common endpoint. That is what this graph is. So now we have a weighted graph. Now we have a weighted, directed, finite, acyclic graph. So let us try and see, what does the LGV lemma tell us about this graph? So the LGV lemma states an equality of two sides. One side is the determinant of the path matrix, and the other side is a certain sum over all vertex disjoint path systems. So for this graph, what is the path matrix and what is the sum over all vertex disjoint path systems? So first let us try to determine what is the path matrix for this graph. So remember what I said about the path matrix. The path matrix has rows indexed by the R1 up to Rn and columns indexed by C1 up to Cn. These are some chosen vertices in the graph. So we have already chosen these to be our R1 up to Rn, and these to be these one to be C1 up to CN. So we have these chosen vertices. For each of these pairs Ri and Cj, I'll have to give you the entry of that path matrix. So let us see what the entry of that path matrix is. So here is Ri. Here is Cj. Now I'll have to put in this entry here. So what is the entry? I said if you have two vertices in any directed graph and you want the path matrix, what you have to do is you have to sum along all paths the weights of the products of the things appearing along that path. So if I fix Ri and I fix Cj here, now and I have in between I have x1, x2, xk, xn, sorry. I have these points x1, x2, x2 up to xn. I fixed Ri and Cj. I want all paths from Ri to Cj. If I look at it, there is one path in which Ri will go to x1 and then x1 will go to Cj. So there is this path. Then there is another path in which Ri will go to x2 and this will go to Cj. So on so forth. Then there is one last path in which Ri goes to xn and xn goes to Cj. So now I will have to determine what are the weights of these paths. This is Ai1, the weight is Ai1. This is B1j. This is Ai2. This is B2j. By definition, that is the weights I have assigned. This is Ain. This is Bnj. And so the entry of that path matrix is therefore Ai1 B1j plus Ai2 B2j Ain Bnj. Now if you look at this, you recognize this of course as the ij entry of the matrix AB. If you take the matrix AB, then its ij entry is of course Ai1, B1j, Ai2, B2j up to Ain, Bnj. So therefore we conclude that this path matrix is just AB. Hence, so we have done part of the work. For this directed graph with 3n vertices and 2n squared edges, the path matrix is just equal to AB. And so in the Lindstrom-Gesell-Vienno lemma, on one side you have the determinant of the path matrix, so we have already got this part. Now we will have to see why the other side, which is this, why is the other side equal to the determinant of A times the determinant of B. So that needs some work. Not much, but some work. Okay, so what is this, what is the other side talking about? The other side is a sum over various kinds of collections of paths, path systems. A path system is a collection of paths from here to here, right? Such that, and it should be vertex disjoint, they should not share any common vertices, and it's a collection of n paths. So let us first see how many path systems are there, right? Let us try and see how many vertex disjoint path systems are there in this graph. So let us try and describe the vertex disjoint path systems. Okay, as I said, it's a collection of n paths. It must go from, okay, let me do an example. For instance, suppose n is 3, say, so this is joined to this, 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 this is joined to this, 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 this is joined to this, 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 similarly this is joined to these 3, this is joined to these 3, and this is joined to these 3. This is the graph. When n equal to 3, I have drawn the complete graph. Now I want a vertex disjoint path system. So I have to begin at R1, right? I'll give you one example. So for example, from R1 I could go to C1 by this. That is a path from R1 to C1. From R2 maybe I want to go to C3, right? So maybe I could choose that path. And then from R3 I have no choice, I have to go to R1. So I have given you three paths, and these three paths are vertex disjoint. They do not share any common vertices. And these paths, oh sorry. Yeah, sorry. This one was right, and then I should have gone to C2 here. Yeah. So I have these three vertex disjoint paths. Now, to every such vertex disjoint path, I have a number attached and a permutation attached. So what is the permutation for this one? For this one, 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 3, and 3 goes to 2, right? So the permutation is 1 goes to 1, 2 goes to 3, and 3 goes to 2. For this path system, this is the permutation. And there is also a weight for this path system. What is the weight of this path system? It's the product of whatever things appear. So here A12 will be there, here B21 will be there, here A23 is there, here B33 is there. It's the product of all those Aijs, Bijs, such that they occur along the path system. Okay, so this is just an example. What you will see is that in general, so what do you notice? What you notice is a complete path system is determined actually by two permutations. First, there's a permutation going from A to the B's, right? These three different A's have to go to three different B's here, right? That gives you one permutation. And then after that, after they end up here, these again have to go to the different C's. So a path system in this graph is determined by two permutations. Let me call one of them sigma and one of them tau, right? So observe that a disjoint path system, a vertex disjoint path system, is determined by two permutations in SN. And what are they? Sigma, where Ri is joined to X sigma I, and tau, where Xj is joined to C tau j. Right, that's what I'm, when I write sigma and tau here, what I mean is the ith one here is joined to the sigma ith one here. And when I write tau here, I mean the jth one here is joined to the tau jth one here. So a disjoint, vertex disjoint path system is determined by two permutations. Not just that, I can take any two. Not just that, it's, these two can be completely arbitrary, right? Further, any two such permutations, such means any two permutations essentially, give a path system, both ways. So I am saying that there is a one-to-one correspondence essentially between the disjoint, vertex disjoint path systems and pairs of permutations sigma and tau. Okay. Now I will try to express everything in terms of sigma and tau. Right. So take a disjoint path system, it will have a permutation sigma and a permutation tau. I want to express this and this in terms of sigma and tau. That's what I want to do. So the sum will now become, instead of summing over all vertex disjoint path systems, it will become a sum over all sigma and all tau, double summation, right? Times this thing, which somehow depends on sigma and tau. Now we will look at how this depends on sigma and tau. Okay, so first, what is the sign of this P? The sign of P means where does I go in this one? So first I goes to sigma I, then it goes to tau sigma I, right? So the permutation from here to here is actually tau sigma. So note that if P corresponds to sigma tau, then by sine P we just mean the sine of tau sigma. But of course we know that the sine is a homomorphism, so this is sine tau sine sigma. Okay, so this part I have written in terms of sigma and tau. Now I have to see what is the weight of P. The weight of P is the product of the weights of all the edges that occur. What are the edges that occur? Here if I see, I will have AI, this is joined to sigma I, right? So AI sigma I. So weight P is the product I equals 1 to n of all the AI sigma I's. And then for these, a j will be connected to tau j, so b j tau j, product over all j. Fine. So that is the way. Now I will substitute all this into the LGV lemma. LGV lemma says that the determinant of the path matrix, so by LGV, determinant of the path matrix, we showed that that was equal to AB, is the sum over all vertex disjoint path systems. That means, as I said, over all sigma in SN and tau also in SN, of the sine of that path system, which is this sine tau sine sigma, times the weight of that path system is this product. Product I equals 1 to n AI sigma I, product j equals 1 to n BJ tau j. Okay. Now this is a double sum. You are summing over sigma and summing over tau. So some of these things, this part, see this part does not depend on sigma, right? And this part does not depend on sigma, right? So I can take those apart. So I can write this, in fact, if you think about it carefully, you can write this as summation over sigma and SN of sine sigma product of AI sigma I equals 1 to n times tau in SN sine tau product j equals 1 to n BJ tau j. Some things do not depend on sigma, some things do not depend on tau, so you can just factor it out and write it this way. But this, of course, we know what this is the determinant of A and that is the determinant of B. And so we have proved that the determinant of AB is determinant of A, determinant of B. So this is typically how the LGV lemma is applied. So let me give you one exercise, which is a generalization of this multiplicativity of determinant. And this is called the Binet-Cauchy formula. So what this states is the following. Here we took two matrices of square matrices of equal size, right? N cross N and N cross N. Now suppose instead of square matrices, we want to consider rectangular matrices. Suppose A is M cross N and B is N cross N. Suppose A is an M cross N matrix and B is an N cross N matrix. Then AB, of course, is going to be M cross M. So AB and we can ask about what is the determinant of AB in this case. What is it? So here, of course, the determinant of A by itself does not make sense, determinant of B by itself does not make sense, they are not square matrices. So the answer is not, is going to be dependent on something else. And what the answer is this Binet-Cauchy formula says the following. So it is a sum over all subsets S of 1 to n of cardinality m So, summation over all subsets S of cardinality m of the set 1 to n of the determinant of AS times the determinant of BS, where what do these things mean? Where AS is the matrix obtained from A by taking only the columns in S, and similarly BS by taking the rows in S. So, this is a formula which I claim generalizes the formula of multiplicativity of determinants. If A and B are square, if m is equal to n, then the only cardinality n subset of 1 to n is everything. So, then you will just get one term here, and that is determinant of A, determinant of B, right, which is the formula we proved. But the same proof, essentially the same proof, almost the same thing, this graph is going to be almost the same, except it is going to be enlarged. So, here is I took m cross n, so here there will be m, n and m there, right. Almost essentially the same proof, if you work through the details, will prove this Binet-Cauchy formula. So, I want to point out a few things about this. So, note, so as first note is, this generalizes, as I said, the multiplicativity of determinant. Second, it says that if n is less than m, then determinant of AB is 0. And so, why does it say this? If n is So, if n is less than m, how can I have a cardinality m subset of 1 to n? There is no such subset, and so the sum is just an empty sum. The empty sum, of course, will just give you 0. Now, this relates to something that Amri mentioned in his talk. So, let me point that out. It is an easy observation, but you may not have quite seen it that way. So, Amri said, invertibility is only for square matrices, right. So, why is it not possible? So, if A is m cross n, why can there not be a matrix B n cross m such that AB is the identity, m cross m identity, and BA is the n cross n identity. And that, of course, this question is only if n is not equal to m. Why can't you have an inverse of a rectangular matrix? Why is it that if you take a rectangular matrix, you cannot have a matrix of the other type, right? If you take m cross n, n cross m, such that when you multiply on both sides, you get identity. Why is this not possible? The reason this is not possible is exactly this Binet-Cauchy. What this will imply is, on one side, the determinant will be 0, right? So, you cannot have it to be equal to the identity, right? This is exactly what this Binet-Cauchy will imply. That can be seen in many ways. This is just one. For example, the rank of one of them will be small. So, you can't, the rank is at most the min of mn. So, you can't have, if they are not equal, you can't have equality there. Okay. Now, next I want to do this another very wonderful application, and this is actually the application that Gesell Viono starts. Their paper begins with this application, and this is something called binomial determinants. So far the application was to algebra, was to linear algebra. Now this is an application to combinatorics. So here is the question they consider. Begin with Pascal's triangle. We are all familiar with Pascal's triangle, but don't write it as a triangle, you write it as a square like this. So 1 1 1 1 2 1. I'll write just one more row. And put zeros, pad it with zeros. So consider this huge infinite matrix. Right? Every row is just the binomial coefficients for that n, right? The rows are indexed, rows and columns are both indexed starting with 0. This is the 0th row, first row, second row, third row, so on. Similarly, 0th column, first column, second column. So this is called the binomial matrix, right? Let's just call this the binomial matrix. Now the problem that they consider is the following. They want to choose a certain number of rows and columns, right? Maybe, to be sure, I'll do the same thing that I did here. Suppose you choose the third, fourth and fifth rows, right? I'm choosing the third row, fourth row and fifth row, and three columns, let us say 1, 3 and 4 columns, 1, 3 and 4. Let me look at some three rows and some three columns for instance and see what are the entries I get. So what are the entries I get? This, 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 and this. So now I have got a matrix. This is a 3 by 3 matrix now. By choosing some 3 rows and some 3 columns, I have got a 3 by 3 matrix. All the entries in this matrix are binomial coefficients, right? So this is 3 choose 1, that is 3 choose 3, 4 choose 1, 4 choose 3, 4 choose 4, and this is 3 choose 4, right? 3 choose 4, there's nothing, you can't choose 4 out of 3. 5 choose 1, 5 choose 3, 5 choose 4. So I have a matrix, every entry of which is a binomial coefficient, right? The problem they considered is to evaluate this matrix. Let me evaluate, the determinant of this matrix, binomial determinant. So evaluate the binomial determinant in this case. It looks like 3 1 0 4 4 1 5 10 5. And they would like to do this in general, right? Not this example, of course. How do you evaluate determinants of this kind? So what is this? What is this entire data determined by? It is determined by a set of increasing numbers this way and a set of increasing numbers that way. Once I tell you what these numbers are and what those numbers are, the matrix is fully determined. So given A1 up to AN along columns, and B1 up to BN along the rows, so consider the matrix whose ij entry is AI chose BJ. Right? That's an n cross n matrix. Every entry is a binomial coefficient. And the problem is evaluate this determinant. Evaluate det P. In closed form. Okay. So I should say right away that they don't do this fully, right? They do not evaluate it in general, but they evaluate it in various special cases which happen to be of great interest in other areas of mathematics. I don't even want to get into that. But what I want to observe is, I want to make just a few observations about this problem and how the LGV lemma applies to this thing in a very beautiful way. So I'll just do this example and it will be clear from this how to do the general case. So here is there the beautiful idea of Gesell-Weyl. And the beautiful idea is, of course, as I said, all these applications you have to have a directed graph to which you calculate some paths and show something. So the beautiful idea is you consider the so-called acyclic plane. So consider something called the acyclic plane. This is a certain directed graph. And what graph is this? So it has these are the vertices. The vertices are all the lattice points. This is a vertex, this is a vertex, this is a vertex, this is a vertex, this is a vertex. So it's an infinite graph, but never mind that for now. So these are all the vertices and the edges are there. Those are the edges. You see the edges and it's directed. So how is it directed? It is directed upwards and to the right. So every edge, up down edge are all directed up and right left edges are all directed right. So this is how the graph is directed. So you have a directed graph and then they want to interpret all of these things as paths in this graph, right? So for example, let me call this the origin 0, 0, right? They consider the following sets of three points for the A's and 3 points for the B's. So what are the 3 points for the A's? So they consider 0, minus 3, 0, minus 4, and 0, minus 5. So let's look at those points. So this is 0, minus 3. 0 minus 4, 0 minus 5. And for the other, for the b's, they consider the point b comma minus b. In this case it is, sorry, the b is 1, 3 and 4, so they consider the points 1 minus 1, 2 minus 2 and 3 minus 3. So that is here. Oh, sorry, 1 minus 1, 3 minus 3, and 4 minus 4. So these are 3 points. So these, let's call this C1, C2, and C3 in our notation. And these are the points R1, R2, and R3. Now the amazing thing is, if you count how many paths are there from Ri to Cj, it will be exactly that binomial coefficient that is occurring there. For example, here is 3, right? So from R1 to C1, there should be 3. Is that correct? So here is R1 to C1. You can go either this way or this way or this way. There is 3. And say for R2 to C1, there is 4. And that's correct. You can go 1 or this way 2 or this way 3 or that way 4. And this is not a coincidence, it's easy to see, right? Let me not do that now. It's very easy to see that the number of paths from Ri to Cj, the path matrix for this graph is exactly this binomial determinant. That is what is not hard to see. That part is not hard to see at all. But it's the conclusions that they draw which are really beautiful. So the path matrix is is the binomial determinant. So what does the LGV lemma say? So the LGV lemma says then that the determinant of that matrix is equal to the number of non-crossing, is equal to, how do I say, is a certain weighted sum of various things. You should have, you should join these three to these three in such a way that the paths do not cross. Then they make another observation, and the observation is if you join R1, R2, R3 to C1, C2, C3 along these paths such that they don't cross, then necessarily it must be that R1 has to go to C1, R2 has to go to C2, R3 has to go to C3. If R1 went to C2, then to get from R2 to C1 you would have to cross, right? So you, there is no path in which, there is no such path system where R1 would join with C2. So R1 has to join C1, R2 has to join C2, R3 has to join C3. What this means is the permutation that you get is only the identity permutation. Since this is a graph, I'm going to weight this by giving all edges weight 1. Every edge has weight 1. So you're essentially only counting paths. So the final conclusion is the path matrix is the binomial determinant. Hence, equals the number of non-intersecting path systems from these points Ri to those Ci. So what is really lovely about this is, since it's counting something, it's a number of something, right? So the path is, the binomial determinant is the number of non-intersecting path systems. Therefore, it cannot be negative. So it says that this binomial determinant is always a non-negative number. That's not at all easy to see. If I just gave you this and said any such binomial determinant is non-negative, then that's not easy to see at all. It's a very strong conclusion to say that this is non-negative. And not only it is non-negative, it's very easy to see the following. It vanishes exactly when sum Ai is less than Bi. See, if Ai is less than Bi, that means this point will be above and the Bi point will be below. So you cannot have a path which goes only up and right there. And that's the only case when it vanishes. If all the Ai's are bigger than or equal to Bi's, you can just look at this picture and draw a path which satisfies the non-intersecting condition. So this is another condition. This is another conclusion that they draw, which again is not something easy to see. And a third and very beautiful conclusion is the following. If there is equality, if sum Ai equals Bi, then I'll denote the binomial determinant by this A1 up to An, B1 up to Bn. This is the symbol, right? This symbol stands for the determinant of this matrix whose entries are Ai choose Bj, right? So this, if sum Ai equals Bi, then this has a factorization, A1 up to Ai minus 1, B1 up to Bi minus 1, Ai plus 1 up to An, Bi plus 1 up to Bn. So notice, I'll justify this in a second. Notice that this is the determinant of an n cross n matrix. This is the determinant of an I minus 1 cross I minus 1 matrix. This is whatever n minus i cross n minus i. So this determinant is a product of two smaller determinants. Again, such formulas are not easy to see. If you don't know where they come from, it's not going to be easy to prove something like this. So why is this correct? Why this is correct is extremely simple. If Ai and Bi are equal, that means at some level here is Ai and here is the point. So this is 0 minus Ai and here is the point Ai minus Ai. If you want a path which goes only up and right, it has to go straight and join. There's no other path. And the rest of the paths, the rest of the points which are above the Ai, which are above this, have to join with these here, and these have to join with these. This number is exactly this by definition, and this number is exactly this again by definition. and so you have this factorization. So all of these things fall out from just this, that one Gesellweian lemma. Now I haven't proved that lemma. The proof also is a very beautiful proof, and I leave it to you to read from that book, the reference that I said. It's not a long proof, about one page long. It's quite and very elegant. So, but I just wanted to show you some of the applications. So I have I have some more applications in mind, but since time is up, I'll just give you one assignment, one more exercise, and stop with that. So this is evaluate using the LGB technique. And this is in closed form. I want a closed form answer for the following determinant. M plus 2 choose 2, M plus N choose N. The last row is just M choose 0 and M plus 1 choose 1. This is a n cross n matrix, and the question is to calculate its determinant using LGB. Now it may actually, initially I thought I'll assign it like this, but maybe it's hard to do. I'll just tell you what the answer is, prove that this is correct. The determinant of this matrix is M plus 1 Cn. This is in fact a closed form expression. See, as I said, LGB generally gives you, it just says count number of paths going certain ways, but it doesn't say how to do that. That needs other techniques. But in this case, it's easy enough to do, not using exactly that, but something similar. And the answer turns out to be M plus 1 chosen. OK, I'll stop here. Thank you. Any questions?